Sometimes a buggy, irresponsible opinions about classic film. I'm Elise.
I'm Dave. This week it's the Hollywood Studios year by year. Warner Brothers 1940. It's a Bette Davis double feature this week, showcasing this actress's range, one of the preeminent stars at Warner Brothers. We'll be talking about The Letter and All This and Heaven 2. Before we do that, let's take a look at Joel W. Vindler's chart of stars at the studio. Habitués of the program will know that Findler has his idiosyncratic 1, 2, or 3 star rating depending on the value of that person in the mind of Joel Findler, which is sometimes easy to understand and other times not. Let's go through all of these stars here. Ida Lupino, 2 stars. This is her first year under contract at Warner Brothers. Edward G. Robinson, 3 stars. James Cagney, 3 stars. Bette Davis, 3 stars. Humphrey Bogart, 3 stars. Pat O'Brien, in the last year of his contract, 2 stars. Olivia de Havilland, 2 stars. Errol Flynn, 3 stars. Claude Rains, 2 stars. Anne Sheridan, 2 stars. Jane Wyman, 2 stars. Ronald Reagan, 1 star. John Garfield, 3 stars. Conspicuously missing from this list, and I don't think we mentioned this last time, where is Priscilla Lane? She should be on here.
Don't you mention that every time?
I don't think I've ever remarked on the fact that he's left her off. It's not right. She was a big star for them from 1938 to 1942, I think.
So you probably would imagine that she'd get 2 stars?
Yeah, I'd say 2 stars would be right. So Findler, if you do another edition, please correct your Lane problem. So we're going to begin with a discussion of The Letter. And before we do that, we'll hear from Clive Hirshhorn and his book, The Warner Brothers Story.
I can never remember what the good one of these books is. Is it the Paramount one?
I think so far we've had the most agreement with John Douglas Eames in the Paramount story, yes.
Okay.
Well, let's see what Hirshhorn has to say. From its justly celebrated opening scene, in which Bette Davis empties a barrel load of bullets into the man she loves, to its eerie climax, in which, courtesy of the Hayes office, but unfaithful to Somerset Maugham, she is stabbed, William Wyler's assured handling of The Letter made compulsive viewing. In a multi-textured part, previously played on stage by Gladys Cooper, Catherine Cornell, and in 1929 on the screen by Gene Eagles, Davis again turned melodrama into art, with a portrayal as finely honed as such steamy material allowed. She received brilliant support from James Stevenson as her attorney, Herbert Marshall as her husband, he had appeared briefly as the lover in the earlier screen edition, and Gail Sondergaard as the sinister Eurasian widow of the murdered man. Cecil Kellaway was in it too, but only fleetingly in a party scene. Contributing to the effectiveness of Robert Lord's production were Max Steiner's dramatic musical score and Tony Gaudio's moody black and white photography. Also in the cast were Frida Inniscourt, Bruce Lester, and Willie Fung. It was loosely remade in 1947 as The Unfaithful, which is a pretty interesting movie too, and Sheridan starred in that one.
That's your editorializing.
That's me. They didn't mention Victor Sen Young, who's got a really important part in this film, the assistant at the law office.
Sure.
All right. Well, not too bad a write-up there.
Pretty standard stuff.
It's pretty hard to go wrong when you're appraising The Letter. It's a great movie.
Even though these two movies feature contrasting Bettys in terms of her moral shading, they do have something quite notable in common, which is that they are both based on real-life sex scandals that involve murder.
Yeah, that's right. I mean, she's in danger of going to jail in both of them.
Scandal that the mom play is based on was the Ethel Prudlock case. And notable differences in the movie that we just watched from the description of this case on Wikipedia are that Ethel was herself a Eurasian woman, and her husband was a headmaster in Kuala Lumpur in Malaysia. So the changes in the fictional version definitely lead to more of an anti-colonial story.
So yeah, that's one thing we need to separate out, right? And the review actually mentions this. Somerset Maugham, it was a story that was turned into a play that eventually became this film.
A difference that was made in deference to the Hayes office from the play, well, one thing that's mentioned is that Davis's character had to get punished at the end, but also the woman who was in a relationship with the murdered man, Mrs. Hammond, she was his Chinese mistress in the play.
Right.
She was changed to his Eurasian wife. Eurasian thing is neither here nor there, but the change from mistress to wife again supports much more of an anti-colonial reading, and so the movie ends up being, in some cases by accident, politically more interesting than either the play or the real life story seemed to be.
Now, Maugham was a very interesting writer. I've read quite a few of his books and stories over the years. He wrote a lot about the British Empire, critical of it, and the way it was exerting its power and exploiting its subjects. There's a lot of scope for that in this story. We'll dispense with the previous iterations right now, I think, just by saying that Leslie Crosby in the story, her punishment is that she has to live with the fact that she's killed the person she loves, right? So that's sort of the Scarlet Street ending.
Sure.
Which the Hays Code allowed in 1945. Of course, but not here.
What ends up happening, her fate in this story to appease the Hays office, makes the story much more gruesome and morbid than it would otherwise have been.
Yeah, I mean, we'll talk about that final scene. It's quite interesting. I mean, it basically a suicide. She's allowing it to happen. All she has to do is not go out and they can't get to her.
But I guess if she committed suicide, no one could arrest her and therefore, you know, close the circle of punishments for murder as neatly happens at the end of this movie and ridiculously.
Yes.
When I was a teenager and a huge Bette Davis fan, this is one of the movies that bored me.
Really?
One of her most famous movies.
I'm shocked by that. I would have thought this would be one of your favorites.
Like, I was only watching the most famous movies and this one didn't appeal to me. This is probably like the sixth or seventh time I've seen it in my life. On this viewing, I would say that the reason it bored me was probably because it's completely perfect. Other than, you know, a little silliness at the ending, as just discussed. That was no fault of Wyler's own.
No, but they did their best to build it into the story. There's a lot of back and forth, and Gail Sondergaard gets a few moments throughout.
Well, no, the only silliness I'm referring to is the police officer
catching the
murderers immediately.
I agree.
Other than that, the movie is just absolute perfection, which clearly my mind couldn't deal with as a teenager. it seems to be boring. That's the problem. But once you are able to appreciate its slowness and its restraint, then you realize that it's actually absolutely taut with tension the whole time.
Doesn't really feel like a Warner's film. It's just got such, as you say, deliberate pacing. It's not relying on quick cuts and ellipses the way so much of Warner Brothers 30s content did, right? The rapid fire montage.
It's really unbearable in its pacing and tension. It's designed to drive you crazy the way it drives her crazy. The last time you and I talked about this movie was when we did a version of this film podcast long before we started this film podcast. We were just going to do some Hollywood actors. It was kind of like an early version, an early conception of the Actourist Oeuvre Review series. And we recorded a bunch of episodes on Bette Davis and Jimmy Cagney, and we never put them on the internet.
That's right. They never got edited. I think I've still got the raw footage somewhere, Ben.
But you and I were talking on that viewing about how this is a relatively uninteresting Bette Davis character because she's, although not to the same extent as in This Our Life, she's kind of just one note of bad woman. But on this viewing, she didn't appear that way to me at all. On this viewing, she was very, although what she does is horrible, she was very, very sympathetic to me.
Yeah, well, maybe you've been influenced by Leonard Maltin's brief sentence on the film, which said that Davis, very appealing in her unsympathetic role.
Yeah, we have no idea what he meant by that, but...
Maltin can be cryptic.
Well, he doesn't have a lot of space to work with.
That's right. Depending on your mood and depending on your attention to what's going on her face and on the screen, you can smooth over some of the...
No, it's not a matter of smoothing over anything. It's... Well, first of all, okay, well, let me talk about how I came to this new understanding of Leslie Crosby. First of all, there's a realization that she's been playing a role her entire life. Like, everything she says and everything she does is a lie. She is this plantation owner's wife, and there's a certain set of things that comes with that, and a whole lot of things that don't. And she is just pretending to be this person while she has all of this roiling, seething passion within her, right? So once you understand that, the whole performative nature of her character, then she starts to make some sense. And then going further along that track, she has an amazing amount of self-awareness. The only blind spot she really has is her racism, but not only is that understandable in the cultural context, but specifically she is projecting all of that sexuality that she feels so much guilt for onto this Eurasian woman.
Played by Gail Sondergaard, yeah.
Right, who is a white actress. Looks sufficiently like Bette Davis that they look like they could be doubles for each other in this movie. Like, he just went and married the Eurasian Bette Davis because she was available, her lover. Yeah, but other than that, she has this comprehension of herself that gives her more depth than the characters around her who have not, like Herbert Marshall and like the lawyer who defends her, their friend, Howard. She just has more depth because she has dipped herself involuntarily into this chaos of sex and murder, right? Passions. These passions that these other characters have not experienced. You know, that line where she talks to Howard about how he's studying her, right?
Because I'm so evil?
Yeah. I was just marveling at Davis's performance in this movie this time because the thing about Davis here at the peak of her stardom, which is her peak as an acteur, right? As someone whose performances make an enormous creative contribution to her movies.
Just to stay on that for a moment, we're not doing this as an actorist overview. Of course, we certainly could have. It's just that there's so many Davis movies we can cover with our Hollywood studios year by year that we're not doing that. But you don't have to look any further than this movie to see her power as an actor, because William Wyler's only at Warner Brothers because she insisted on it.
So what she does during this period is... she makes very, very unexpected line readings. Like, I kept comparing the way that she delivers these speeches to the way that an actress would intuitively reading the lines on a page, and it's radically different. A lot of it has to do with acting in this dissociative way, which works really well for this character who's going through major trauma the whole time that we see her in the movie, right? She's just dissociating from every emotion she's experiencing and everything that she's saying, and that comes across in the way that she reads the lines, which in some cases is like reading lines. It's not like she's putting any kind of emotion into them. She's distancing herself from them.
Well, of course, she's written a script for herself that she's been adhering to throughout the marriage, and it's a convincing performance because Herbert Marshall is ecstatic with their marriage until the moment that he learns it wasn't what he thought it was. She's also convincing in terms of dealing with the government and legal matters.
But you see what I'm saying about Davis and her way of reading lines. She never goes for the obvious emotion. Well, the evil.
Well, that's a really interesting line in itself, though. It's not a stock line. So it really lends itself to an exciting moment for an actor, I think, no matter what. Because obviously she both does and doesn't think she's evil, and we feel the same way.
Yeah, I mean, on the one hand, she feels very guilty. She's felt very guilty even during this whole affair, right? She's ridden with sexual guilt, and she certainly is consumed by guilt for having killed this man that she loves. But on the other hand, I think she thinks the concept of evil is silly. So on the one hand, yes, she's completely emotionally convinced that that she's evil and also thinks it's silly.
Yeah, exactly. She is gazed into the abyss, which I think is what you were saying before, basically, right? That these other guys have been able to comfortably inhabit their roles. Now, I think you're undercutting the role and the amazing performance by James Stevenson, because he too is confronted with the abyss in this story and discovers that he's not what he thought he was, or at any rate, he can never be again what he thought he was.
Well, the structure is interesting in that he does all of this, like, compromises his career and his soul, his integrity, to protect Herbert Marshall. But there was never going to be any way to protect Herbert Marshall, as we discover in the scene where it all comes out after the trial, after her acquittal.
In fact, the thing that capsizes that whole plan is Leslie's honesty. She's not a consistent femme fatale or anything like it. She makes a full confession when asked at that point after the trial. She does not try to make up another story, which presumably the lawyer would have went along with just to protect his friend, but she makes a clean breast of everything. And then she gets another chance to patch over the problem, and she reveals once again that no, she's too tormented. All she can focus on is the fact that she killed Hammond and she loves Hammond. She can't even just say that she loves Herbert Marshall and then try to believe it or act like she believes it. She's been doing that for 10 years. She won't do it anymore.
Well, I feel like the whole house of cards was coming down anyway after Herbert Marshall discovers that he has no more life savings. But it's true that rather than just letting that house fall down without adding anything to it, she does take that opportunity now that the cat's out of the bag to give a full soliloquy.
Yeah, exactly. And that's not what you'd expect. If she was a thoroughgoing villain, that's not what she would do. And then it would be up to the lawyer to continue to intrigue against her or something, or try to find some way to bring his friend to the light while he's being re-ensorcelled by this evil woman. And that's not how the story goes at all.
No, a femme fatale doesn't have any self-awareness.
No, or any moral compass, right? Bette Davis's character is tormented in a way that you just can't be if you're one of these femme fatales, because all they exist to do is to create torment for other people.
Now, we should contextualize this by saying that the letter is sometimes discussed mostly for its visuals.
Well, it's beautifully shot, there's no question.
But also for its opening, it's often discussed as a proto-noir. But as we're saying, there are a lot of ways in which it's not that.
No, I think it is a proto-noir. It's just not a proto-femme fatale. She's not a femme fatale, but she's a noir character. The noir character is usually a man in most of the movies in the 40s who is morally compromised and self-hating.
It reminds me a lot of, as I was thinking on this viewing, of Dreyer's Day of Wrath in certain ways, in that by the end of that movie, the main character speaks what she believes to be her truth, her confession, which is that she's a witch and is responsible for her husband's death through witchcraft, when she didn't need to do that. Now, she's pretty much being condemned anyway at that point, but you get the feeling that there's a relief and a satisfaction for her in making this confession, that there's a truth that she wants to speak here about how she perceives her marriage and her role in society. And that's what I feel is similar to the transformation that Leslie undergoes at the end. It is also similar to, specifically, as you were saying with, you know, how she's similar to a noir hero, it's a little bit similar to They Won't Believe Me.
Yeah.
Where Robert Young is acquitted of murdering his wife, but then
he's dead already.
Right. Because he's already passed judgment on himself for being an asshole in general, and specifically contributing to a chain of events that led to her death.
Right. Yeah, it doesn't matter if he was technically guilty.
And of course, Leslie is technically guilty.
She certainly is. So we should back up a little bit and talk about the milieu that we're dealing with here. This seems contemporaneous. I guess it's set in the late 1930s, let's say. It's Malaya, and it's a rubber plantation. We've seen this milieu before on the podcast in Red Dust, although this is a very different presentation of that milieu and a very different angle of approach on it. Herbert Marshall is basically the Clark Gable in this story, running the plantation, but it's not his, right? He works for masters overseas.
Well, he's living a lot less rough than Clark Gable is, though.
Well, that's what I'm saying. It's a different presentation of the same role, though. He has the same job.
Yeah.
It's just the movie is envisioning that job very differently.
Which movie is accurate?
I think probably both, depending on the state of the plantation and the hands-on nature of the manager, I guess is what he is. He seems to delegate a lot more. He seems to trust the people that work for him a lot more than Clark Gable, who basically needs to do everything himself.
Right, and these two are living like rich white people would anywhere.
Seems very similar to the way an Old South plantation would be run in an antebellum film.
They're part of this colonial social set,
yeah,
that they throw parties for.
And the movie has some really nice little subtle digs at this whole society, this whole...
Well, and some that aren't subtle at all.
Yeah, sure. And the Victor Sen Young character...
Nor do they need to be.
No. But his character is just amazing. And it's a great performance, too. Just the way he's introduced as this superstar intern slash assistant around the office, who Stevenson tells us is going to open up his own law office very soon and become competition. And so there's already this tension there, but major respect. And then we see he's going to use all of this stuff to his own advantage throughout and get in some good jabs at his boss and all of his boss's friends. And those scenes are so beautifully done. And of course, Stevenson is an important part of it too, trying to maintain the facade of the colonial overdog while realizing very quickly that he's in a tough position. He's going to have to give in to any demands that are made by his underling.
I suppose we should say that the screenwriter here, Howard Koch, was blacklisted.
Yeah, he wrote a lot of Casablanca as well.
The subtle and unsubtle digs, there's no need to look any further as to where they're coming from.
And we know Wyler was a Hollywood liberal as well, not a communist, but definitely someone who was interested in a progressive vision of America.
Although he kind of maybe slips up on that a bit in parts of Jezebel, but...
Well, of course, that's, you know, just a quagmire. Anytime you start doing anything dealing with the Old South, you're in trouble.
Although it is relatively progressive.
Yeah, if you line it up against Gone with the Wind, it looks progressive. But then again, many aspects of it do not stand up.
The comedy doesn't stand up so well.
No. No, here we've got a more thoroughgoing, because of course it's not invested. The Hollywood system and the American company making it is not nearly as invested in protecting any vestige of the history being presented here or the society being presented here. It's British colonialism. It's not America, so they can criticize it a little more freely. Warner Brothers certainly was more critical of the South than any other studio, but as we see in things like Jezebel, they will indulge the Old South mythos a lot more than anyone needed to.
I mean, we've got Jezebel on the list, right? So we'll thoroughly talk about that at some point.
There's a large cast because there are some party scenes, but really it's just a few actors. And it's like a chamber piece. Herbert Marshall doesn't have much to do in this movie.
Other than bring his Herbert Marshall qualities of cuckoldedness. And that can go either way for him. He can play the cuckoldedness in a way that's very mild and masochistic, like in this movie, or he can be a total asshole about it, like in Blonde Venus, or kind of maybe like something in between in The Little Foxes, but still be hampered by physical disability.
Yeah, but that one does give him more to do, right? He's got a daughter that he has this strong relationship with. He's got some really tense scenes where he's having medical crises. Here, he just crumbles a little bit every time he learns more about what's really going on.
Yeah, but he's pretty clueless for a long time.
Exactly.
So the lawyer is the one, that's why they have this conversation about her evil, because the lawyer is the one who becomes her confidant because he finds out what's going on.
Exactly. So those are the two most important performances, and they're both brilliant.
And so he is trying to understand her this whole time, that she is also trying to understand herself, but the main difference between them is that she's kind of come to the point where she realizes she can't, that she can't understand herself.
If the movie had continued and examined the rest of his life, I'm sure he would come up against a similar impasse. Like, why did he do this?
Like I said, like, supposedly it's to protect Herbert Marshall, but that doesn't work at all, and it seems like it never could have worked.
No, if you game it out 99 times out of 100, it still goes wrong. And if they really wanted to protect Herbert Marshall, they should have destroyed the letter and just told him, yes, we destroyed the letter for safekeeping or whatever. Then he never reads it, and they can tell him whatever they want about the innocuous contents of the letter.
And that's a really interesting shot when she petitions him to do this. Wyler's shooting her from behind and she's lying down having fainted in the prison in this little hospital room on this examining table. And we just see the back of her and her hand goes up against the wall. It's very seductive, but in a subtle sort of way, you know? It's weird. What is going on with them in that scene? I mean, she's appealing to him. I don't know. I feel like she's somehow appealing to him as this fragile white woman that she's pretending to be even after the facade has come off, you know? Like, he's trying to save that image. I also feel like she, after she's killed Hammond, doesn't care two pins for her own life, but she still cares about her reputation. But then after the acquittal, even that goes to hell and she doesn't even care about that anymore because somehow, I guess the guilt of being acquitted.
Well, that's a very Dostoevskian.
Yeah, the guilt of being acquitted is what causes her to not be able to give this performance anymore.
Right. She kills this guy, goes into crisis mode, figures out a solution she thinks will work, lies to the police, lies to everybody, and is thrown into the machinations of the law. And while that's all going on, the adrenaline is pumping and she's not thinking, or we don't see her thinking that much about the bigger moral crisis, right? And as soon as she gets out of that snare, miraculously, with the help of James Stevenson compromising his ethics and his soul, as you say, then there's really nothing left for her but to confront what she's done. And that's how the story ends, and that's the point of the story.
Yeah, that's right, because she has no more crisis to deal with anymore. She just has her life to live, and she has no reason to do that anymore. A good example of Leslie's performances, that is one of the great details that Wyler puts in this movie, is after she's told her rape story. She serves dinner to the lawyer and the young policeman and her husband.
He says it's his first case.
And her husband. I mean, and she's just back to putting on this absurd act of the colonial wife who cares about what people think about her cooking, right?
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. There's just such a nice, creepy tension in that scene.
Yeah, stiff upper lip.
It's grotesque.
It is. It is. Well, it's certainly grotesque once you know what's back of all of it. When you're watching it the first time, presumably you think, well, no, you can never think that because we see her face when she shoots Hammond. So it's never a mystery.
We also get a lot of shots of her staring at the moon and going back and forth between her face being lit up by the moon with those eyes, right? Her huge, shining, crazed eyes. And then her face going back into darkness as she looks down at what she's done.
But the movie, I think, plays fair with us. We never have any reason to think, even if people didn't know the earlier movie or the story or the play.
And this characteristic delivery that Davis has at this point. She uses it a lot in Now Voyager as well. She uses it in All This in Heaven too. This delivery that's like partly Shatner pauses and then just an over enunciation and then these completely flat line readings that just seem like trauma. Everything she's saying is distanced from her, which also works extremely well for Now Voyager because her character is also in trauma throughout that movie.
She plays a lot of traumatized characters during the height of her stardom. It's one of her stocks in trade.
So her line readings during this rape scene, like they're never convincing until she gets into it, until she really gets into it, because it works. It's just such a fascinating sequence to watch because of the strangeness of Davis's choices, acting choices.
But they all go hand in hand with the character that she's tried to build.
Because you're going back and forth between asking yourself how much of this is just plainly unconvincing and how much of it is this really limited woman, you know, this genteel woman trying to deal with the terrible trauma that she's just been dealt by this attempted rape and this murder that she's committed, right? So how much of it is just her not being able to express what's happened to her or not being willing to express it, and how much of it is just the falseness of the story? But then by the end, she gets really into it when she gets up and actually does the blocking, right? And that seems to be Leslie, the character that Leslie has created, breaking down, you know, and her own repression, her own modesty in front of all these these men breaking down. So there's just so many layers to it of what is Bette Davis doing versus what is Leslie doing, who's putting on what performance at any given moment. Davis is the most actressy of all the great Hollywood actresses of this period, and so many of her movies are about her giving various types of performances.
Well, she's doing method acting here, not Bette Davis, but Leslie Crosby, because she is building up, and by the end, yes, she is making use of the intense emotions that she felt when she decided she was going to kill Hammond for refusing to continue to have a relationship with her by transmuting that into an emotional scene where he attacks her sexually.
Right, right. But she's always thinking about, even as she does this, she's thinking about the effect it's going to have on the people she's telling the story to.
Yeah, of course, because she has to have a really convincing story that blends intensity, because a decision to grab a gun and kill someone is involved, but also automatism.
Not just kill them, but kill them 6 times. Yeah, that's the thing, that Davis is constantly, this is what I'm talking about, good word, that Davis is constantly going into this mode of automatism in her movies at this time.
Yeah, and it's important for this film, because otherwise no one's going to understand why she shot him 5 times after he was dead. So she has to access that intense emotion in order for people to understand the kind of psychotic break that she's positing that she had, and that she actually did have. But for totally different reasons.
Right. Now, to me, the most incredible scene in the movie is the confrontation between her and Mrs. Hammond.
Yeah, Gail Sondergaard. Now, Gail Sondergaard is an amazing performer as well, who had difficulty fitting into Hollywood. They never knew exactly what to do with her. The most famous example of that is that she was cast as the Wicked Witch of the West. And she actually inspired the witch in Snow White.
I thought it was Crawford.
Well, I thought it was based on Sondergaard, but maybe there's a bunch of apocryphal stories. Anyway, I know that she was cast, and there are all kinds of production shots of her in the role, and then they were like, oh no, she's too beautiful. We have to get rid of her and get a real wart-nosed witch.
In Wizard of Oz, you mean?
Exactly. She often plays very foreboding, dangerous women.
But here, she's actually, that trope is actually reversed.
Yeah, exactly.
She is righteous fury.
That's right, exactly. This was a really good use of her, although a very small part, but certainly very memorable.
Incredibly impactful. It was actually reminding me of second greatest non-speaking, although she does have some lines, but they're not in English, quote-unquote non-speaking, reproachful performance in a movie after Anna Paquin in The Irishman. The movie, much like The Bitter Tea of General Yen, doesn't undermine, well, it does undermine them, but it doesn't forego Orientalist tropes. It really, really, really leans hard into them.
It leans into them, and mostly with a purpose to re-examine them, but maybe not all.
Well, I don't think to re-examine, but just to repurpose, because she becomes this magical apparition when she emerges for this meeting that she's demanded with the woman who killed her husband. In this scene, Davis, although her character expresses racist scorn for this woman both at the beginning and at the end of the movie, which is fitting for a woman of her race and class, when she confronts Mrs. Hammond, there's none of that. She knows that she is in the wrong, and their face-off between each other seems to me to be the most truthful and emotionally loaded moment in the whole film. And then Mrs. Hammond throws the letter on the floor and, you know, treats Bette as the whore that she is in this situation.
There's no solidarity between women here.
She killed her husband.
I know. Saying.
And I mean, the fact that Bette is wearing this white lace veil, that is, you know, it's obviously subverting the pure and innocent white colonial woman trope.
Yeah, she's forced to remove it in order to receive the contraband letter. Willy Fung is in the background laughing. He is a character actor that we've met before. He was not asked to perform very dignified roles, although in this one, and I guess a lot of the time, his role is mostly to laugh at the white characters, right? He's in Red Dust as well.
Yeah. I just kept wondering, at the beginning of the scene, before the emotions took over, I did keep wondering how she was going to explain the smell of incense when she got home to Herbert Marshall. A lot of incense in that scene, as well as pipe smoke, or I don't know what that's supposed to be, opium? Like, I have no idea.
Well, on those kinds of tropes, yes, you would have to think it's an opium den of some kind.
Yeah, but he himself does not seem opiated.
Well, he's laughing a little bit too much.
He's pretty lively, though.
He's not taking this thing very seriously, and why should he, right? It has nothing to do with him, except he's getting a lot of money.
I was actually, like, in tears. The scene put me into tears this time, because it's just so charged.
Yeah, it is. And I have no idea if that's in the story. I don't remember, or if they created this scene for the movie.
Well, as I said, she's not his wife in the play, so it would not have the same degree of impact.
No, but I don't know if she insists on a meeting at all.
Right. I didn't read the synopsis of the play, so I don't know.
And of course, a lot of the things going on here are, you know, the animosity and the tensions are stand-ins. They're focalized on this murder, but the resentment of people under a colonial regime.
Yeah, obviously. And I mean, that's brought home by the fact that this houseboy, so-called houseboy, runs away on that night too, and he ends up, you know, he turns out to be a friend of Mrs. Hammond's.
Yeah, and obviously he was a friend of Mr. Hammond as well. He's the one that finds him. He says it's Mr. Hammond. He goes into the house. He actually has some pretty good moments there as they walk around and she stalks back and forth and he's sort of examining things. He has a little bit of time to occupy the screen and give us a little sense of where his mind is trending. We certainly take his hint that there's something weird going on here.
Yeah, so we see that
he finds the lace work and
we see that there's a general resentment of these colonial masters.
And with good reason, and the movie supports that. It accepts that. It doesn't act as if, oh, this is unreasoning hatred of the benevolent whites. No, you never feel that.
Well, she's a little bit like, you know, Daisy in The Great Gatsby. She's just running roughshod over other people's lives just because she thinks that her feelings are more important than anything else. But yet, the movie shows us, and this is why she was sympathetic to me on this viewing, the movie shows us how she's trapped by gender. And that is what makes her as sympathetic as she can be. Because, as I say, she's been forced to perform this entirely artificial role her life.
Yeah, and of course, I guess the main symbol of all of that, right? The character that she's fashioned is likened to the lace work that she does. And both things can keep her mind off of the roiling tensions that we know are going on, right? And that's what Stevenson and other people ask her about. Like, the lace work, it's something that helps her to get through prison. It helps her to get through a lot of things. And likewise, presenting this face to Herbert Marshall and to Herbert Marshall's friends has kept her stable and kept her afloat through all kinds of very tense years, it seems like.
And the other women don't need this.
Well, Frida Inniscourt, her character too, it's a small role. She's the wife of James Stevenson, the lawyer's wife. She just seems to inhabit that role very uncomplicatedly. Now, the movie's not focused on her, so we don't know what struggles she's gone through in her life, but she's just supportive of everybody in the community and jokes around a little bit wherever she can, tries to keep things light. And that's an interesting role for her because she usually plays a jerk as well. She plays Mr. Bingley's sister in Pride and Prejudice. Here she's kind of a breath of fresh air.
It's like what we were saying when we discussed Splendor in the Grass in a Fear and Moviegoing section. It's impossible to say why some characters just inhabit these very, very limited social roles apparently with ease and without complication, and some characters can't. But Leslie is one of the characters who can't, and that's why she's taken refuge in her lace work for so long. But ultimately, it's not going to save her. And the particular arrangement of characters in the screenplay makes you feel like what sets her off and makes all these passions come out so violently is the racism, is the racial situation onto which she has projected everything she hates about herself in classic othering, right? Everything she is not supposed to be.
Certainly what sets off the final descent into madness, which is where where we catch up with her at the beginning of the film. But obviously, she's been in trouble for a long time, because this affair, we're told, has been going on for years.
Yeah.
But yes, discovering that she's lost this man to another woman, and a woman who is supposedly in a lower caste.
Oh yeah, and we should point out, when it's first discovered that he has a Eurasian wife, Howard, the lawyer, points out that this has turned public opinion against him. The idea being that if a man...
If he'd do that, well, you can't trust him around a white woman at all.
Well, exactly, that he would do anything sexually if he would have sex with a Eurasian woman.
Very, very nice use of actual racial attitudes and turning them against the society that we're depicting here.
Yeah, so this is what Leslie thinks. You're lower than the most abject creature imaginable if you have been rejected in favor of a woman like this.
And just to get into the Hays Code's bizarre idea that for them it was unacceptable for him to have a Chinese wife, that's just beyond the pale, but to have a Eurasian wife, that's just within the pale. So they were allowed to do that. Fucked up.
Fucked up moral system? Yeah.
Yeah.
It's really interesting to compare this movie as a slightly more hiddenly progressive film on race that nevertheless makes use of Orientalist tropes that are common in Hollywood. Compare it to Bitter Tea of General Yen, because when she talks about this woman as being sort of this glittering idol, how distasteful that is, well, this is what Barbara Stanwyck ends up transforming herself into in Bitter Tea of General Yen.
Well, right? Yeah, this, showy clothing.
Yeah, so
and
this
jewelry and...
this idea of this weird Orientalist fantasy of the sexualized Asian woman, that also becomes Barbara Stanwyck's other self in a completely different way in Bitter Tea of General Yen.
One last word about James Stevenson. I've mentioned him before, but it is one of the great tragedies of Warner Brothers history and Hollywood history that this guy came along, did some amazing work. This is right at the top, and Shining Victory, 1941, poised to do a lot of other great things. We've seen him in smaller roles where he does great work as well, in King of the Underworld. We're going to actually do that movie on the show at some point. White Banners. He was poised to become a major star at a weird time of life, like he was in his early 50s, and then he just died.
Oh, that's too bad.
It is, because I really like him in this movie.
I guess we could also just briefly mention, last time we talked about William Wyler, I think, was when we did The Heiress, and we had occasion to mention then how it's not the only thing he does, but atypical Wyler auteur move is to make a movie that contrasts extreme restraint and or constraint with tumultuous passions underneath the surface, and what a perfect example of that this is, and how ideal Bette Davis as central figure in his movies.
Yeah, the idea that Wyler doesn't have any themes that he likes to explore is ridiculous.
Or style, because this is also style that we're talking about.
Yeah, it's a recognizably Wyler film. It doesn't look like any other Warner's film, and they won't make any other movies that look like this.
Or that have this kind of icy restraint.
No, that's not the Warner Brothers way. Let's see what Clive Hirshhorn has to say about all this and Heaven 2. Adapted for the screen by Casey Robinson, from Rachel Field's bestseller, All This and Heaven 2, took its time, 140 minutes, to recount, in flashback, the true story of Henriette Deluzy Desportes, a governess accused of having had an affair with her employer, the Duc de Pralines, and participating in the murder of his wife. A subdued Bette Davis played the governess. Charles Boyer returned from France especially to appear as the Duc, and the supporting roles were filled by Virginia Widler, on loan from MGM, Helen Wesley, Walter Hampton, Henry Daniel, Harry Davenport, George Koulouris, June Lockhart, and Anne Todd, the American child actress, not the British star. Budgeted at $1.4 million, the rights alone cost $100,000. Producer Hal B. Wallace and his associate David Lewis had every confidence in director Anatole Litvak's ability to deliver them a hit. He did. Song All This and Heaven 2 by M.K. Jerome and Jack Scholl. Well, song didn't actually appear in the movie,
no,
as far as I know.
That says almost nothing whatsoever about the movie.
No, just says the cast and a little bit about the source material.
Also kind of burying the lead when it comes to discussion of the source material, because
it's a true story.
And not just that, but this scandal contributed, as the Wikipedia entry says, contributed to the political turmoil before the French Revolution of 1848.
No, this article doesn't.
No.
It definitely led to, you know, I think it was going to happen anyway. There had been a revolution in, of course, the 1789, the big one, then 1830, and then in 1848, basically there were revolutions everywhere in Europe.
Yeah, but it became a focal point for anger anyway.
Of course.
This affair.
And of course, we know what happened there because of our experience with Suez. That revolution didn't generate much excitement. It turned into Napoleon III and the French Empire again. But that is the final monarch in French history. They got rid of a king.
Also of interest, the author of the novel, Rachel Field, was related to this woman. And that's why she wrote a novel vindicating her.
I'm so interested in Rachel Field. I've never read any of her work. Her books were highly regarded by people. They couldn't be relied upon to support this kind of popular literature. And it seems like there's something there that a lot of people were responding to, a lot of highbrow intellectuals.
The real life Henriette seems very interesting and led a very rich, although unfortunately not that long, life after this scandal in America.
Rachel Field didn't live very long either. Unfortunately, she dies in 1942.
She married a minister in America, Henry Martin Field.
Played by Jeffrey Lynn in the film. He appears mainly in the framing sequence.
I think he gets a different name in the film. No, he doesn't. Know it's the same name.
Yeah.
They had a literary salon where, among other people, Harriet Beecher Stowe showed up.
Yeah.
Samuel Morse, Fanny Kemble, Wlliam Cullen Bryant. She also studied art, which isn't dealt with in the movie at all. Became a member of the School of Design for Women at Cooper Union's Advisory Council. Was a principal of the art department in the early 1860s and exhibited works at the National Academy of Design.
Apparently the novel goes into a lot more of her time in America because it's a gigantic book. It's like 600 pages, but obviously the movie felt like they had to do something to cut it down to something like a regular feature film, and it's already well over 2 hours, so I think they probably made the right choice, but I would like to have seen more of the American stuff as well. I'll have to read it.
So this is one of your favorites?
I love this movie. I've always loved it. I think it's a great Davis performance. We talked just last week about Edward G. Robinson giving his milquetoast and his gangster performance in the same film and that undercutting each other, but we're not against star personae having a wide range. I've always loved the fact that Bette Davis could play someone as deeply compromised and perhaps hateful in some ways as Leslie Crosby, and then in the same year play a character like this who is basically a saint, but a very understandable saint, I think.
Well, she's not quite a saint. I wouldn't quite go that far.
Pretty close.
No, I wouldn't say that. They do talk about how if he kept on introducing temptation, if they kept on, you know, being alone together, that probably an affair was going to ensue. That's the implication. So they're not, you know, they're mortal.
Yeah, well, no, I'm not calling her a total alien, but she's a very, very admirable person in this film, and by design.
Yeah, but at the same time, it does seem to be partly the situation that she's stumbled into. Like, nothing she does seems unbelievable.
No, I agree. I mean, that's part of the magic of the film. She seems like a human being.
She's just a person who likes children, who's being contrasted with a very neurotic and difficult wife who's in a terrible marriage, right?
And I think that scene where she discusses her past and her family and she says that there's some mystery about her birth, that was really an amazing scene where she talks about how she's a shell of a person.
Well, yeah, she was illegitimate. So I was very pleased to know and to get the hint at the end of this movie, too, that she wasn't going to have to be asexual for the rest of her life.
No, although they really soft pedal the romance with Jeffrey Lynn, and I'm sure in the novel there's more because these are her ancestors.
Yeah, the author's ancestors.
But the focus here is on the love that she has, the love that can't express itself with Charles Boyer, and Jeffrey Lynn offers her a different kind of love. Obviously, it's not going to be the great passion of her life, but they seem like they're going to make a go of it, and at least she can have some kids of her own.
And at least he's not part of the Catholic Church.
Well, it's a very anti-Catholic film, that has to be said. Now, apparently the book has a lot about her confrontations with stern Puritans as well when she gets on the other side. Now, obviously, Geoffrey Lynn is on her side, that minister, but his dad apparently is a big problem.
Well, they sound almost like...
Unitarians.
Transcendentalists.
Yeah, Geoffrey Lynn seems like part of that circle, right? And it's exactly the right era for these adventurous left-wing Protestants in the Boston area.
Yeah, but as you say, like, the whole framing device is there to make the point that America isn't necessarily going to be any better.
No, of course not. Of course not.
Any more accepting or open-minded. So I found this, I was a little bored by it for the bulk of the story. I thought it just seemed like kind of a conventional governess falling in love with her employer who's in an unsuitable marriage movie. Some nice stuff with the kids. But it's after the wife is killed that things go really fucking crazy and get very political.
Yeah.
The whole society literally turns against them. And then it starts seeming more like something like Parnell.
And that's not an accident. Obviously, Anatole Litvak is a very political filmmaker, and he would have been fairly fresh off of one of his big triumphs in Europe, which is Maeterlinck, which was doom love story. You know, it's the background to the From Maeterlinck to Sarajevo story.
Right. I was actually thinking about the Ophuls version of that while I was watching this. I kind of actually ended up preferring this to that. I don't know as a piece of movie making, but as a political love story, I really got into this by the end. And all of the themes that get involved in terms of this great love being warped into something so ugly and horrible that it results in this insane murder. Yeah, I was pretty into it by the end.
It's an incredible movie.
Does not go where you expect it to go.
No, I mean, you could see Charles Boyer is unraveling. There's some foreshadowing for it, obviously.
I could have used more, but...
I think he does a good job of making it all seem like something that could happen, right?
But I love his performance afterwards.
His deathbed scene.
Yeah, and the fact that these lovers can never publicly say how they feel, or they will be...
Or who's going to get her killed.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, it's quite a story problem to heap on Charles Boyer, so he has to take poison to protect her life. Otherwise, they're going to go to the scaffold together, and that's what everyone wants, right? They want... Because what the king wants and what the people around the king want is to say, well, okay, we are going to bring this peer to justice, but really he was misled by this evil commoner.
Well, and it turns out that the people were against her, too. That they sided with the wife.
Yeah, of course they would. Of course they would.
But it all became associated with the idea of a corrupt peerage.
You know? And people above the law.
Yeah. At the beginning of the movie, when she first becomes employed by this family, she does talk about her family's association with the Napoleon family.
Yeah, and her grandfather was appointed to the Napoleonic aristocracy, which is a totally different thing. Yeah.
And I don't know what her... She says something about her political views differing from his, but I don't know what exactly that would mean in this context.
Well, she was presumably a Republican, right?
So an anti-monarchist.
Yeah. So probably someone that would have supported the 1848 revolution if she hadn't had to run away from the country.
Did that mean much of anything other than simply being anti-monarchy?
Well, it was a protean thing, right? This was one of the big revolutionary moments. This is the moment that inspired Marx, right? This is where Marx is writing the Communist Manifesto. This is what he was hoping to see all across. It was an incipient social revolution in Italy, in France, in Hungary, in a lot of places. It was put down almost everywhere, except in France, where they succeeded. But, you know, it's such a sad fizzle because Napoleon III winds up being made president, and then he appoints himself dictator for life, emperor for life. France doesn't become, you know, a leading light of the march toward socialism the way Marx was hoping in 1848, but it could have gone that way. And there were certainly people participating in that revolution that wanted it to go that way. It just didn't ultimately.
Right.
So just a couple of months ago in When Tomorrow Comes, our Universal 1939 film, we saw Charles Boyer involved in a similarly awful marital situation with the very same actress, Barbara O'Neill.
Oh, that's funny. It's such a... I mean, I can see that now, but it's such a different performance that I didn't put that together. No.
Yeah, well, this character is really thrown under the bus. I mean, the other character was deeply problematic, but just a little bit of light shed on what might be going on with her.
Now that you mention it, he even makes a speech in this movie about the horrifying power of the weak that's similar to the one that Irene Dunne makes in that movie.
And we talked about this in that episode as well, but this is not the only thing that Barbara O'Neill could do, right? Because she plays the unbelievably perfect bourgeois woman in Stella Dallas.
Yeah. Is Litvak doing a stall here or something? Is this his stall tribute?
You could see it that way for sure, right? It's got some elements of that, undoubtedly. It's a little bit more intense than stall will get, like sort of nakedly intense.
Well, stall's pretty fucking intense at times. Backstreet's pretty intense.
He likes to really do that transcendental mode where it's all the iceberg method. It's just as intense when you really think about it, but this has more overt dramatics to it, I think. Which I like as well. I like it when it's done well this way. I think Charles Boyer is really good as someone who is really driven to plotting his wife's murder and then finally doing it when goaded in the exactly wrong way or exactly right way. That scene where she reads off the two letters, neither of which has been written, it's a pretty bravura taunting scene, and I don't know how she expected to survive if she's been living with Charles Boyer and seeing his eyes get more and more insane. But...
Well, she has said to him before that, God willing, there would come a time when she could torture him the way that he tortures her.
Yeah, and really, he has to kill her for that prophecy to come true. So I guess that's what it is. She doesn't want to get murdered. She certainly tries to fight him at the end, but in the final analysis, I don't know what else she's looking for, what else she's hanging
around
for.
Well, she has no way of getting out of her obsession other than being killed.
Exactly.
So maybe some part of her does want this to end somehow.
She certainly seems to want death.
Well, she attempts suicide earlier, right? And ends up attacking him. Or anyway, he ends up getting harmed in the process of stopping her.
The letter opener.
The thing is, as unpleasant, relentlessly unpleasant as her character is, and I guess has to be in order for us not to be too sad when she gets killed, for Charles Boyer not to lose his hero status, I think you always feel that there are these larger social forces operating on all of the characters.
Yeah,
I mean,
of course.
If she wasn't obsessed with him, as Bette Davis frequently talks about, if she wasn't obsessed with him, maybe she would just accept a separate lives sort of arrangement, but divorce is not possible for them.
No, there's Catholic officials hovering over them all the time. Yeah. That evil priest. Just wait.
Showing up at the wrong moment every time.
He's always there. Of course, she's constrained by the way she's been formed as a subject. Her insanity is a direct outgrowth of that.
Her father actually does seem like a sympathetic character, but he isn't in any way helpful.
The Maréchal.
Yeah.
No. Now, one thing that I think the movie does an incredible job of, and then sort of, it's kind of horrifying, just leaves you hanging. What happened to these kids? What are their lives going to be like?
They're fucked.
We never see them again,
They're clearly just completely destroyed.
And what a lovable group of kids.
They're all going to commit suicide.
I can't think of a movie that has more endearing kids in it than this, don't you think?
They're just constantly hoping that mom will be happier and that they can just spend more time with the happy people.
That's right. And they're just such nice scenes with them, and some pretty intense scenes too. The one with June Lockhart is brilliant. I just love it, where she basically begs Bette Davis to explain what's about to happen to her when she gets thrown onto the marriage market.
A lot of this, interestingly, anticipates her scenes in Now Voyager, where it's all focused on one child, right?
Yeah.
But there, the child is like a substitute for the father, but here, the love between them grows out of their shared love for the children.
Yeah.
It's not some kind of...
proxy.
Well, no, it's not some kind of extraordinary sexual passion that just flares up between these two characters. It is this common interest.
Yeah. Virginia Wyler, I think, is excellent as well. We always talk about her when we can. This is the same year as Philadelphia Story.
Yeah, well, yeah, she's not being a precocious and annoying character. She's being like a normal kid in this movie. It's strange to
see.
No,
it's nice to see that she can do that too. Well, she's maybe more interested in the arts, the high arts, than a normal 12-year-old would be. But
yeah, she's the one who gets really excited because Victor Hugo and Chopin are there.
That's right. That's right. So she's a little precocious, but not
obnoxious.
Not like Dinah. I really like Harry Davenport as Pierre in this film as well, and all the stuff that goes on with the snow globe, the snow scenes. Just a lot of beautiful shots in this movie too. The interesting Halloween interlude with the titles on the screen that say when the witches are abroad or something, when the witches ride.
Yeah, that was odd because that's a strange setup for a tryst, which is what it initially looks like we're going to get.
It's fascinating. That was like a nice walk in the fall woods.
So yeah, there's all these like endless cozy scenes with these children interspersed with these terribly traumatic outbursts.
Machine gunned full of holes by the neurosis of Barbara O'Neill and her evil priest familiar.
She's got a lot of evil familiars. She's also got that ex-governess who's still hanging around spying.
And George Koulouris too, the fake valet, the spy.
And so all of this is like driving Charles Boyer out of his mind.
And when he screams at George Koulouris to get out and go tell your master I will deliver a full report myself tomorrow. I mean, he's really cracking up. And this is a marriage that you could see just eroding a person's brain. Both of them are going down.
Yeah, and you can see that from the moment
they're introduced, really.
They're introduced, and she can see that as she listens to them arguing through the door. And I guess initially she thinks that she's going to at least provide some comfort to the children.
But the children are such a contested issue that it's never going to be a separate sphere of influence. There's
right.
always going to be some bleed over into the marriage.
Right.
Because Barbara O'Neill is feeling displaced and feeling like she can't play her social role properly. There are real causes to Barbara O'Neill's madness.
Well, yeah, but the way it's presented is as a self-fulfilling prophecy.
Yeah, yeah, it's a death spiral from the beginning, from the first moment she walks in. And of course, Davenport warns her. He's like, you're going in that house? Don't do that.
And there is honestly no way for them to be together.
No.
If they run off on their own, he abandons his children. If they take the children, they will be persecuted. There's nothing.
Quagmire that has such incredibly fun, cozy, lovable moments all the way through, but you know, well, we already know it's leading to death and disaster because the framing sequence tells us that she spent time in the conciergerie and that she's a transatlantically famous criminal or accomplice to a crime. And so we know something very bad is going to happen.
After the crime is committed, though, the more they insist on the fact that this love that they did feel for each other is not the kind of love, the way in which it's being interpreted by everyone around them, this sinful, primarily lustful emotion, the more obviously heroic and transcendent it becomes. They will not say that they love each other, partly because it will end in their death, but also partly because no one can comprehend the way in which they did love each other, this in this filthy minded society of priests and peers.
So it is a shining victory, ultimately, for Bette Davis anyway.
Well, for Boyer, too.
Yeah,
there was no other way out of this.
I mean, it's more of a tarnished victory for him because he had to beat his wife to death, apparently. It wasn't like strangulation. There's blood all over the place. It just sounds horrible.
Well, yeah, that's what she, like I said, what she's talking about when she says that their love was twisted into this nightmare.
And she knew, Kent mentioned this letter to Charles Boyer. And that's on Helen Wesley, the landlady, because she's the one that takes him aside and tells him, hey, do you realize that Bette Davis hasn't paid her rent in 9 months because your stupid wife won't write this letter of recommendation? There you just see his mind is gone. He has a moment where he comes back from the brink when he thinks he's actually going to get the letter and he's apologetic to Barbara O'Neill, but she pulls that rug out from under him very quickly. Just a nightmare ensues.
You really need, like, a David Lynch for that scene.
Well, to show the murder?
Yeah, he goes, like, not necessarily to show it, but to convey the emotion in the middle of this cute, cozy movie that it's been
up to now in many ways. I find it more than shocking enough.
He goes full Lost Highway.
He does. He just flips out, and she screams, and then the camera cuts away. But yes, we're told in gruesome detail what it must have taken for him to complete this act.
I mean, yeah, that is what we have to keep in mind. storyline that ultimately this crime has to be pinned on this foul system that we see at work throughout the movie of the priests and the peers.
It's quite an interesting sequence of events at the end when the police are investigating. You have Henry Daniel with his usual cold-eyed glare, wanting to charge the Duke, but knowing that he can't unless he gets a special permission from the king or from the House of Peers.
And of course, Boyer plays all of that very nicely, just turning into a little snot at those moments. Oh, you're the police, you can't do anything to me.
Yeah, it's pretty cool, and it definitely makes you sympathetic. You kind of are triumphing with Boyer as he enjoys his immunity, his diplomatic immunity, but you also are more sympathetically disposed than usual to Henry Daniel as he, you know, reaches out for the next best thing, which is to try to get Bette Davis because she is within the reach of the law.
Yeah, and of course then the class imbalance becomes glaringly obvious.
Yeah, it's a really interesting movie. I mean, so many dimensions to it, and I think Litvak does a great job of exploring them to their fullest.
It's a very, very unusual love story in the end. Anything we want to say in particular about, even though this isn't an actorist of review, anything we want to say in particular about Bette Davis's role or performance?
I guess I was saying it a little bit at the beginning, right? That she has this beatific side to her that she can bring to roles. This is not the only one, right? She's definitely got this going for her in The Corn is Green as well. And I can think of a few others. Oft-quoted line about at the height of her stardom, only a mother could have loved Bette Davis is not right. They're leaving out so much of her persona. She's not just Leslie Crosby.
And again, she plays this character as, I don't know, repressed isn't the right word, because what she's doing is more conscious than that. Like, self-restrained.
Level-headed, right?
Well, that too, but she's also putting tremendous restraints on herself.
Yeah, but I just think it's important for us to point that out, you know, that we often think of Bette Davis in a more histrionic key, but so many of her roles emphasize her ability to remain on an even keel when faced with extraordinary upsetting circumstances, right? Those movies with Miriam Hopkins, that's what that's about. The Great Lie, same thing. So many movies where she is the one keeping things together, keeping things under control, and that's certainly what's going on here as well. And maybe the ultimate character in that vein, although it's a little bit more one note, but I still really like it. Her performance in The Man Who Came to Dinner just really distills that down to that's all she is in that movie. She's just level-headed, dealing with the antics of Monty Woolley.
But you feel all of this sorrow and loneliness that she talks about?
It's incredible. Yeah, I mean, that talk again, and well, I mean, I've already discussed it, but bears repeating, that scene where she discusses her feeling of being cut off from any normal life plan, that someone in her class, because she's not a poor woman, her grandfather's not a member of the true French aristocracy, but still, he was elevated by Napoleon and not cast down, so she obviously grew up in a kind of luxury as well. That's why she's so well-spoken and educated. She had a lot of advantages, but because she was born illegitimately, she doesn't have the option to have her own kids. She doesn't have the option. So she's a parasite, or she's doomed to playing an observer role in this society.
Yeah, she's level-headed by necessity, sort of.
That's right. I mean, she tells us right from the beginning in that scene where she meets up with Jeffrey Lynn on the boat that she's always had to fend for herself, and she's not, doesn't need his sympathy.
I kept thinking, partly her performance and partly the way that she's styled, I kept thinking how good she would be in Charlotte Bronte's Villette.
Yeah.
You've read that one, right?
I have, yeah.
Where this governess suffers unimaginable losses and traumas through the duration of the movie. It's one of the most utterly despairing books I have ever read in my life. And I think Bette Davis would be great in that role.
Yeah, I actually had a moment talking about what she would have been great as, thinking about her profile in a couple of shots, and I guess the way her hair was done looks a lot, very strange. strangely looks a lot like the one existing photo of Margaret Fuller. They should have done a Margaret Fuller movie starring Bette Davis. That would have been quite wonderful, I think.
Yeah, I guess her character is kind of splitting the difference between Margaret Fuller transcendentalism and Charlotte Bronte nihilistic despair at the contingencies of life.
Yeah, and I get the sense that that's what Rachel Field was aiming at, right? She wanted to tell this story about her ancestor. She's inserting this story into the 19th century context in a fascinating way. And she is a New England novelist, like Olive Higgins Prouty,
who wrote the source material for Now Voyager. And of course, Bette Davis is famously one of the big New England stars of the era, along with Katharine Hepburn.
Yeah, two very different products of New England. So there's our Bette Davis double feature. We'll certainly see Bette again many times as we go along in our Warner's journey.
I tend to forget when I'm away from her for a while and looking, because she was my favorite actress as a teenager, my first great actress love. When I'm away from her for a long time, I tend to forget how truly great an actress she is.
Should not be forgotten.
Still my number one from the era, American actresses.
Well, she's always going to be right up there for me as well. It's pretty silly of me to go around talking about Jean Arthur being my favorite or Stanwyck being my favorite. Well, there's many great ones.
There's favorites in terms of personalities, and then there's like just who gives the top-notchest performance.
She almost never lets you down.
I don't know if that's true, but the best of her performances are among the very greatest.
Yeah, well, I feel like I can name about 20 incredible performances by Bette Davis, so that's quite a resume.
For me, it's her and Jimmy Stewart at the summit. But yeah, he also gives a lot of bad performances.
Yeah, he winds up being in a lot of movies that... I don't know. I don't think there's any Ice Follies of 1939 in Bette Davis's career.
Not even in her early Warners period?
No.
No, they didn't. They really didn't ever put her in things that were just silly, did they?
Nothing that silly, anyway. I guess we'd have to really explore. But I've seen most of her movies from the 30s. Biggest sin that you'll see in the really early ones is that she has nothing to do.
Yeah.
Three on a Match is the ultimate example of that. One of my very favorite pre-code films, and Anne Dvorak is out of control, great in that movie. Joan Blondell is doing amazing work. Warren William, all kinds of people really delivering maximal entertainment, and Bette Davis is just a milquetoast secretary. It's just ridiculous, the contrast there, when you know who this is and what they were doing with her, which was nothing.
I feel like no one ever seized their peak of stardom in quite the way she did.
Yes, and she fought the studio for that, right? And she was so valuable that she managed to win, right? She walked out, insisted on getting better roles, and immediately, or after about half a year, she did. So she didn't have to sit out a couple of years, and she didn't have to go to another studio. Jack Warner caved and gave her what she wanted, which was like 7 years of the best vehicles anyone could ever ask for.
And they're vehicles. They're vehicles designed for her shining beacon, like Casey Robinson, who writes the screenplay for
King's Row as well.
All This in Heaven 2. We've talked about him before, but he just wrote screenplays for her time and time again. Yeah, these are movies designed around her performances.
Towards the end of the 40s, it started to get a little bit dicier.
Yeah, of course. Well, when I'm talking about the peak of her stardom, I mean from the late 30s through the early 40s, it wasn't that long.
No. But they did stick with her all the way to 1949, and she doesn't leave Warner Brothers until Beyond the Forest, which I think is an amazing movie, but it was not heralded that way at the time.
Yeah, it's a pretty crazy performance.
It's great. So good. We've got Fear and Moviegoing in Toronto as well this week, Elise. Our last movie at the theater till August, we saw eXistenZ by David Cronenberg on Wednesday night.
Oh, that's right.
What did you think? You had never seen it before, right?
No. I've only ever seen a handful of Cronenberg films. Nevertheless, it was very easy to detect the sort of remix going on in this one, which primarily of Videodrome and Naked Lunch, updated for the gaming era. I was surprised by how sexy Jennifer Jason Leigh was in this movie, because normally I don't even like to look at her.
Well, you know she is my favorite living actress, but I don't understand why you'd be surprised she's sexy.
Cronenberg gets good results with unconventionally sexy women. He did the same thing with Judy Davis and Naked Lunch, so that part of it didn't surprise surprised me. I enjoyed her a lot in this film. I enjoyed Jude Law also a lot in this film. They're a fun pairing.
And he
was also very easy to look at. The film itself was incredibly slight.
I agree.
It amounted to nothing.
Of course. Of course. It's kind of a...
I mean, and there are Cronenberg films that I love, so I have nothing against him, personally, but this was a nothing.
It's a fairly rote mindfuck movie.
Yeah, but it didn't even fuck enough with your mind. It didn't fuck with your mind to any purpose.
No.
And it wasn't even that interesting along the way, other than the lead performances, and of course, Willem Dafoe, anytime he shows up in a cameo, always enhances a movie.
Yeah, I think that that's probably true. I think
It also felt so promising at the beginning that just added to the sense of disappointment.
Agree. It's a pretty silly movie, ultimately.
Yeah.
It's really
pointless.
It's a dream within a dream within a dream, except it's a game within a game within a game, and you're trapped in it forever. It doesn't ever let you out, or does it?
But it also had no meaningful theme that I could detect. No theme that had any meaning for its creators.
Well, just Ludditism, I guess.
I don't even believe that there was any emotional investment in that. That was just like a concept.
Death to the demoness.
See, I loved that. I was waiting to see where that was going to go. I was like, oh, is Cronenberg going to do his misogynist thing? That could be interesting, but nope.
Well, no, because the final demon is a guy.
Yeah, I just felt like he had no investment in this movie at all. I don't know the circumstances in which it was made.
Well, I think he was very invested in the body horror aspects of it, right?
Yeah, but he always does body horror. Sometimes it has a purpose.
Well, you'd have to tell me more about that. I'm not a Cronenberg fan at all. I watched this movie. I went to it immediately just because I'm an obsessed Jennifer Jason Leigh fan, and I enjoyed it for her.
Yeah.
And I still enjoyed it for her. I hadn't seen it since the 90s. You know, it delivered everything I wanted it to do. It was fun to see Sarah Pauli at the end there too. And Ian Holm. A lot of fun actors in this movie doing silly things. And yeah, there's nothing much more to it than that, right? In the final level of the game, or supposedly reality maybe, where they all are talking in their real accents about how silly their accents were through the whole movie. Christopher Eccleston as well, the revival Doctor Who guy.
Yeah, who's in there for like no point, for like an entire maybe 5 minutes of screen time?
Well, it's just to have him do like a Italian guy accent. it's a very silly movie, but very gross. Well, all the stuff with the hole that has to be filled.
The sexual.
That's what Cronenberg is interested in this story.
The sexual organic machines. He did that in Naked Lunch, and all the anus stuff is in Naked Lunch. Like, I feel like all of that stuff was done better, and I'm not a huge fan of that movie, but all of that, including the mindfuck, was done better in Naked Lunch. And then Videodrome, I don't even care about at all. The one Cronenberg movie I care about is Dead Ringers, and I think it's a perfect movie, and I think everything he ever had to say ever is in that movie, and his other movies are at best like a weak echo of those themes. But
I do think A History of Violence is a pretty interesting movie that you probably would...
Yeah, I'm not gonna never say never to a Cronenberg again, but if someone vouches for one, I'll check it out. But
yeah, we haven't seen the new one. The whole reason for the Cronenberg retrospective, it's a mini retrospective, they're not showing all of his movies, but they're doing it to support the fact that he's got a new movie out right now. Anyway, that's eXistenZ. We won't be talking about it anytime soon as a real entry on an episode. We do have our Jennifer Jason Leigh actorist spotlight coming up in about 6 years. But eXistenZ wasn't one of the movies I chose. I am going to do another batch of six at some point, but I still don't think it would make it into that batch either. There's just too many good ones.
I was glad to see that Jennifer Jason Leigh can be sexy.
Of course she can, and she can just be really fun and entertaining as well, as she was in this. So that's it for this week. Next time out, it's our July special subject. It's Duels in Max Ophuls. So we're going to be talking about Libelli, a German film made right before the Third Reich takes over. We'll be talking about Letter from an Unknown Woman, made in Hollywood, and The Earrings of Madame De. So we're going to see Charles Boyer in a totally different context next week.
Definitely some themes from All This in Heaven 2 will be recurring in some of those films, but also Howard Koch, who wrote the letter, also wrote the screenplay for A Letter from an Unknown Woman.
All right, so there's going to be quite a bit of interesting continuity next week, and spoiler alert, there are duels in all all three of them.
So show up with your pistols at dawn.
That's right, and your seconds.